haven't seen you lately.
How you been?
Do you already speak?
No.
Oh, good.
אחרי כל הפסגות שכבר נכבשו, כפי שראינו בסרט, אדוני, למה עוד אפשר עוד לחתור או לצפות, והאם יש פסגה נוספת שאתה באופן אישי עוד שואף אליה?
קודם כל, אנחנו כל הזמן בנתיב עלייה, וכל הזמן שיתוף הפעולה המודיעיני, המבצעי, בתחומי ההגנה, בתחומי הביטחון, כל הזמן במסלול של עלייה בשנים האחרונות, ובעוצמה אדירה. בשנתיים או בשנה האחרונה. אדירה. אני לא מפריז, אני זהיר מאוד באמירה שלי. יש כאן שיתוף פעולה שלא היה מעולם בתחום הביטחון, ולדעתי זו רק ההתחלה. עכשיו, אני אתן לך דוגמה. How's your Hebrew? Good. Okay, you've heard of the five eyes, right? That's the five eyes of American allies in intelligence. There is a sixth eye, and it's, in my judgment, the first ally of the United States in intelligence, and that eye is Israel. Israel not only receives intelligence from the United States, but Israel, I believe, gives the United States intelligence second to none, none in the world, and that makes Israel a tremendous ally of Israel, of the United States, okay? The second thing that's peculiar about Israel is that we don't seek American boots on the ground. We don't seek America, we don't ask America to fight for us. Can you name any other ally of the United States that categorically says that? Can you?
I'm listening to you.
No, I'm listening to you. I'm waiting to hear.
So
Israel, Israel is the best ally the United States can have. The third thing is that Israel makes technology which services not only intelligence on the governmental level, but also in every field of human endeavor. We're in the middle of a revolution, technological revolution, and the future belongs to those who innovate. Bill Ford, Ford Motor Company, came here and said to me, you have the best mobile, smart mobility technology in the world. And I said, you mean the second best smart? No, no, he said, no, the best. We're here, and we're opening more and more and more. Eric Schmidt of Google told me, you have, in the areas that I'm interested, the best technology in the world. And I said, you mean second? He said, no, no, the best. And so on. It goes on and on and on. So Israel is a valuable ally of the United States, not merely in intelligence, not merely in defense, but also in civilian areas that change the lives of everyone. And here's the last point. If Israel wasn't here, the Middle East would collapse. And I think it's very important that the Middle East not collapse. I think the fact that Israel is here assures that our flanks, and therefore the entire region, remains pro-Western, pro-American, I have to say pro-American, insecure from the force of Islamism and from Iran, and other forces. I think these are, this is the reality that is being increased all the time. Where would I like to see it go? More of the same, more and more and more of this, but also perhaps to institutionalize the alliance in such a way that it will stand the winds of change for the foreseeable future. I'm thinking about it. I've talked to President Trump about it and to members of his administration. After we win the next election, we'll take it forward. Thank you.
You want to speak about the elections?
No, sure. If you really
in America or in Israel? They have also elections.
Now, you know, I don't know where I'll fall flatter on my face if I do that about that or here. I'll think about it.
Anyway, you mentioned, sir, Prime Minister, you mentioned boots on the ground, and that makes me think immediately of Iran, of course. Look, you make me speak English. This is you. I wanted to speak in Hebrew, of course. Anyway, you spoke about boots on the ground.
נעליים על הקרקע, זה לא אותו הדבר.
זה לא אותו דבר, אתה רוצה גם שאני אתרגם לא נכון, אבל לא נורא.
מגפיים על הקרקע.
אז נחזור לאיראן, אדוני. איראן שוב עלתה לכותרות בימים האחרונים.
האם התגובה של הממשל להפלת המל"ט האמריקני במפרץ הייתה נכונה, קרי פגיעה כלכלית ולא פגיעה צבאית, ובכלל, כיצד היית מתאר, אדוני, את שיתוף הפעולה והתיאום הביטחוני עם הממשל האמריקני בסוגיה האיראנית?
מה שקורה עם איראן זה שאיראן קיבלה מתנה ענקית בהסכם הגרעין. הסכם הגרעין נתן לה דרך חופשית, פתוחה, מובטחת, להגיע לארסנל גרעיני תוך כמה שנים. בלי לשנות שום דבר מההתנהגות שלה, פשוט לתת לה זמן לחלוף. ויכולה, תוך כמה שנים, היום זה עוד 5-6 שנים, יכולה להעשיר אורניום, שזה הליבה של פצצות גרעין, בלי הגבלה. יכולה עם צנטריפוגות שבינתיים היא מפתחת, שהיא עוד יותר אפקטיביות. ולכן, תמורת איזו הקפאה זמנית של ההשערה לפצצה אחת, היא בעצם מקבלת את האפשרות להשאיר 100 פצצות, 200 פצצות, להפוך לכוח גרעיני עולמי. זאת התקלה הראשונה של ההסכם. התקלה השנייה היא שקיבלה מאות מיליארדי דולרים, גם בכסף וגם באשראי, מיד, עבור, במרכאות, הוויתור הזה, שהוא שום, לא ויתור, הוא מתנה. קיבלה שתי מתנות ענק. ההנחה של חותמי ההסכם היה שזה שווה את זה, כי אם איראן תקבל את הכסף הזה, איראן תהפוך למדינה שוחרת שלום. זו הייתה ההנחה שלהם. היא תמתן את ההתנהגות שלה באזור. מה שקרה זה שההפך הגמור התרחש, ואיראן התחילה בעצם לקחת את הכסף הזה, ולהפוך, להשתמש בו כדלק למכונת המלחמה, הכיבוש והטרור שלה. That's what happened, אוקיי? אני התנגדתי כמובן להסכם הגרעין הזה. זה לא היה פשוט ללכת לקונגרס האמריקני. It's always difficult for an Israeli prime minister to challenge the policies of an American president. And certainly I had no desire, particularly desire to do so, but I felt compelled to do so because I thought that this deal, if unchallenged, would jeopardize, would imperil the survival of Israel. So I went there. I then went and talked to the two candidates, Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton, and I said, you must abandon this deal if you're elected. Well, both of them heard me out. Trump said, this is the worst deal in the world. That's what he said. It's the lousiest deal. Whoever made this, who ever made such a deal? I'm paraphrasing because he was a little less diplomatic, okay? He won the election, and he walked away from the deal and reimposed sanctions, which I think is great. Just a terrific thing. And I want to applaud in general his administration, which is represented here by three distinguished diplomats. Ambassador David Friedman, America's ambassador to Israel, Ambassador Jason Greenblatt, President Trump's emissary to the Middle East, Ambassador Nikki Haley. She was very soft in the UN, you know?
Very soft.
Very soft in the UN. And that's an amazing team, along with the others in the administration. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a very forceful turnaround, but the most dramatic change is not only the recognition of Jerusalem as Israel's capital or the movement of the embassy here and the recognition of the Golan. These are historic things, mm-hmm. historic things. But equally, and no less historic, historically significant, is the decision to walk away from the deal. When the president walked away from the deal, Iran tried to do two things. First, they tried to implant themselves militarily in Syria. We resist that all the time. We refuse to accept. We will not let Iran entrench itself militarily in Syria, and we do what is necessary to prevent that. So we're fighting Iran militarily in Syria, and President Trump essentially is waging a very forceful confrontation with Iran economically. Iran is suffering, that regime is suffering. Because they're suffering, what they're doing is trying to use all sorts of methods and proxies and so on to pinprick in the Gulf, mm-hmm. and possibly to escalate in Syria. Possibly. We have to resist them and confront them. I think the president's decision to put more sanctions is the right one, and my decision to prevent them from entrenching themselves in Syria is also the correct decision. We have to keep up the pressure. Just keep up the pressure. And don't relent.
But Prime Minister Netanyahu, first of all, you mentioned that Ambassador Ailey is here with the other very distinguished American guest here. And the fact maybe that Ambassador Ailey is here with us in Jerusalem and not at the UN permitted the Iranian ambassador to be a bit harsh today. Never mind, you didn't answer me if you were...
I don't even know what he said. What did he say?
You don't know what the Iranians say, sir?
No,
you're surprised.
I was in a helicopter.
He was a bit harsh, and they're not very happy right now with the sanctions. But if we speak about sanctions in the Iranian deal, last night, and we spoke about elections, not yours. Let's speak about American elections. That's easy. They had a debate yesterday in Florida, and 9 out of 10 candidates, what did they say? They want to go back to the deal. That worries you, what's happening in the America, but on the other side of the Democratic Party?
Well, it's wrong. I think that any objective look at these, at the consequences of doing that would come to the conclusion that it would actually hurt the interests of the United States and the region and so on. And look at the region. I always say when the Arabs and Israelis agree on something, you may as well pay attention. Maybe we know something about this region, and we do. Iran is the single greatest threat to world peace today and on the horizon, and it should not be allowed to get nuclear weapons. To go back to the JCPOA means letting Iran get nuclear weapons. President Trump has said he will not let Iran get nuclear weapons. I, as the Prime Minister of Israel, tell you, I will not allow Iran to get nuclear weapons. It's a mistake to go back to the JCPOA.
I think many here agree with you, sir. Do you mind if we go back to Hebrew just for one or two questions?
אני אשתדל.
Good. מה ההישג הבולט ביותר של ישראל במערכת היחסים עם ארצות הברית? הכרזת הנשיא טראמפ על הכרה בירושלים כבירת ישראל? הכרה אמריקנית בריבונות ישראל ברמת הגולן? או הכרה שקיימת זהות אינטרסים אליה בסוגיית המלחמה בטרור, אדוני?
All of the above.
All of them, the same. You know, we mentioned before, it wasn't my plan, the Democratic Party. We mentioned the debate yesterday. And then I'll ask you in Hebrew again, מה חייבת ישראל לעשות על מנת לשמר את הבסיס הדו-מפלגתי של היחסים המיוחדים? ובאמת, האם אתה מודאג מהסחף לישראל שחל באגף הליברלי, במפלגה הדמוקרטית?
קודם כל, אם יש לך פרספקטיבה היסטורית על זה, ההנחה שהתמיכה בישראל, בארצות הברית, תמיד הייתה שווה, דו-מפלגתית ושווה, היא לא נכונה. במשך עשרות שנים, התמיכה היותר חזקה הייתה במפלגה הדמוקרטית, והמפלגה הפחות חזקה הייתה במפלגה הרפובליקנית.
טרומן, תוך 11 דקות, היה דמוקרט שהכיר במדינת ישראל.
כן, אייזנהאור הכריח את בן גוריון, יחד עם הרוסים, דרך אגב, לסגת מסיני. דרך אגב, אתם רוצים פרספקטיבה על כמה העולם משתנה? עכשיו הייתה לנו פסגה.
יש לך 4 דקות ו-10 שניות לעשות את זה.
שלשום הייתה לנו פסגה פה משולשת עם ארצות הברית ורוסיה על איך אנחנו מוציאים אויבת של ישראל, איראן, מסוריה. אז זה חתיכת שינוי. איך אתה אומר חתיכת שינוי באנגלית? That's one hell of a change in our international standing. And I'm very proud that we're leading this change with the strongest relationship that we've ever had, the strongest alliance we've ever had with the United States, and with good relations with Russia. And Israel is in a position to speak to both, and I'm looking for a zone of agreement. That's jargon, but it's really a zone of agreement in Syria, because I think all of us agree on the end goal of getting Iran out of Syria. We have a small matter on how to accomplish that, but
sure.
But it's an important starting point. So in any case, it wasn't always the case that Republicans supported Israel more and Democrats less. It was actually the other way around. For a time, it evened out. And now it's changing. It's changing not because of Israel. And first of all, there's a lot of support in the Democratic Party there. Let's not give that up in any way. And I certainly do not. I do not give up on the bipartisan support. But it has changed over the years. The reason it's changing, I think, is not related to Israel. It's related to America. and to changes that are taking place in the United States, I think we have to do everything we can to maintain powerful support for Israel in both parties, but I don't think that we can assure that that level would be even at all times.
Mm-hmm. Prime Minister, we have here with us this evening, straight from Bahrain, Special Envoy Jason Greenblatt. Prime Minister, between you and me, would you have liked to be in Bahrain this week, you personally?
Well, in an air-conditioned room.
But if we speak about Bahrain, of course, we speak of this ultimate...
I don't speak of my travels in the Middle East and daylight.
You don't speak daylight?
No.
So let's speak about something we can. I mean, that's not traveling. You can be in Israel, in Jerusalem, and think about the ultimate deal. Mm-hmm. And I'll ask it in Hebrew. אתה מאמין שבאמת בסופו של דבר נמצא פתרון לסכסוך הזה כאן, במקום הזה, שאנחנו נמצאים בירושלים?
קודם כל, כדי למצוא פתרון לסכסוך צריך לגשת לשורש הסכסוך, ושורש הסכסוך היה ונשאר הסירוב העיקש הפלסטיני להכיר במדינת היהודים בגבולות כלשהם. זה השורש האמיתי של הסכסוך. כל השאר נגזרות, אבל זה השורש של הסכסוך. זה אחד. הדבר השני, אני חושב וזה דורש פתרון פוליטי כמובן, אבל אני לא חושב שכתוצאה מזה שזה קשה או שצריך לעשות אותו בשלבים, בגלל זה צריך למנוע או להחרים את הפסגה החשובה הזאת בבחן. הבסיס הכלכלי הוא חשוב, הוא מנסה חשוב ליחסי דו-קיום, בסופו של דבר גם לשלום. הוא לא פותר את הצורך בשינוי אידיאולוגי בצד הפלסטיני, אבל הוא מכשיר את זה. ואני לא מבין איך יכול להיות שהפלסטינים שצריכים לדאוג לעמם מקבלים הצעות להשקעות מסיביות של עשרות מיליארדי דולרים, והם אומרים, לא מעניין אותנו. אז זה אומר לך שהאידיאולוגיה הרבה יותר חזקה. האידיאולוגיה לא נותנת להם לעזור אפילו לעמים שלהם. ביחס לבחן, אני הסתכלתי, ג'ארד קושנר וג'ייסון גרינבלט היו בירושלים והראו לי את פרטי התוכנית. התוכנית הזאת היא חזקה מאוד, כי יש לה רעיון אחד עמוק וחשוב ואמיתי ביסודו, וזה להחליף סעד בהשקעות. בעצם להחליף את הכלכלה הפלסטינית שמבוססת... It's a welfare-based Palestinian economy. Mm-hmm. And what Jared and Jason have proposed in the Bahrain conference is basically to change welfare into investments and actually connect the two. I think that's a brilliant idea. How do I know? Because we did it in Israel, and it worked. That's why we are where we are today.
Prime Minister Netanyahu, time's up. Still, yeah. One question that I have to ask you.
Well, who says time's up? I mean, just
they say it's not me, the
cares?
Organizer. Who am I? You are Prime Minister. We are yeah. Editor, but we yeah. Don't decide here on the yeah. Stage. You are Prime Minister. First of all, everybody, I think, should... I think on the 20th of July, you're going to break the record of Ben-Gurion to be the longest term Prime Minister of Israel. Is that so? It's long, huh?
Who's counting?
Oh, you're not counting. Look, but I counted and I checked. So it means that you worked with three American presidents, I think, yeah. Bill Clinton, is that so? First term. And then President Obama, how can we forget? And then we have President Trump, how can we forget also? If we assume 2020 elections, let's imagine that you and me would like the same person to win. Let's assume, maybe I'll take it for myself. How many more presidents are you intending to work with, sir?
Not more than three or four, no. I know, I'll tell you. First of all, yes. It's not what I decide, it's what the people of Israel decide. But even that's not true, because they just decided. They decided very clearly, I mean, a majority of the public decided that they wanted me as prime minister, and parties ran for office promising that, and you know, our system is changing. I'm thinking of studying Italian, you know, but even Italy has stopped doing this. I mean, this is an unfortunate turn of events, but it's the deck you're handed, the deck of cards you're handed, so we'll deal with that. I don't know, it's for the people to decide, and one would hope that the politicians would do what the people genuinely want, because I think that usually breeds the best government. There is no other substitute. As far as America and Israel are concerned, I'll say this, to summarize what I said in the beginning, and I truly believe this. I think Israel has no better and greater ally than the United States, and the United States has no better ally than Israel. This is not a slogan. It's true. This also doesn't mean that we don't have many, many other alliances or relationships or friendships that are forming in the world because of our power, our technological and economic power on the one side, our intelligence and military power on the other side. That's causing just about every country in the world to come to Israel, and you see it in the flourish of economic activity. This is a reversal of what my opponents constantly believed and advocated for decades. They said, first we'll make concessions, dangerous concessions to the Palestinians in order to get acceptance in the Arab world, in order to get acceptance in the wider world. Mm-hmm. My position has been the exact opposite. First, we get accepted in the world, then we get accepted in the Arab world, and then we'll work to get acceptance, a realistic peace with the Palestinians. I think we're doing that because we've increased Israel's power in these areas, but the United States is different from all the other countries that are coming to Israel. The United States has a partnership with Israel that is based on this. It's the city on a hill. It's the vision. The vision thing, you know? It's history. It's values. It's democracy. It's sympathy. And it works both ways. We're all pro-American. Thank you.
We all agree with you. Thank you very much, Prime Minister Netanyahu, City of the Hill, Reagan, of course. Let's go back. And what can I wish you tonight? To work with many, many American presidents. Thank you very much.
Thank you.